So yesterday we have been discussing about square integrable functions. So actually in the case of quantum mechanics, you can actually extend this to three dimensions. So whatever the position basis you have been discussing, it was basically what we said was x prime is equal to delta x minus x prime. So now you can actually do this for a three-dimensional case. So the corresponding thing will be r. R will be a vector, okay, and r prime will be delta cube r minus r prime. Okay. So in this case, the completeness relation will be integral, the three-dimensional integral, then ket r bra r will be equal to identity operator. So any state, if you take ket psi, so that you can actually, now you can multiply this identity operator. Ket r bra r psi. So this one you can define as psi of r, which is equal to bra r psi. So the ket psi, I can now write it as integral d cube r psi of r ket r. So this is what the case of three-dimensional position basis, if you expand the state, okay, so this is what you are getting, and this ket psi of r is a three-dimensional wave function, okay, psi of, so in the case of harmonic, the hydrogen atom and all, it is a three-dimensional case, right, so it is the psi of r vector, okay.
Sir?
Yeah.
How fluctuation thing?
How?
Sir, ket x bra x equal to delta x minus.
This one you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Huh. So this is, see, if you know that in the discrete, so this is a continuous basis, x is a continuous basis. The discrete basis, you know that if it's an orthonormal set, if suppose ket phi I are the basis vectors, and then I can write down the orthonormality condition as phi I phi j is equal to delta I j, right? This one, it is clear to you,
yes, sir.
Right? Now this is phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, it can go to infinite dimension, but it is not continuous, it is a discrete, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, you can, each one you can number it. But in this case, now you are extending this to an infinite dimensional basis. So the ket x form a basis, okay. So it is given to you, I am saying ket x is a basis, okay. So like ket phi I is a basis. Or x cap, y cap, z cap is a basis. Okay? So, ket x is a basis. Obviously, in that case, I have to define the orthogonality condition for the different base. So, this is how much, this is a set. Okay? So, a basis always you talk about a set, right? So, x cap, y cap, and z cap. So, this is a one set. These three vectors form a basis for a three-dimensional Euclidean space. So ket, so if any n dimension in, I can write down ket set phi I, where I is equal to 1 to n. Okay, so this n vectors form a basis. So in the infinite dimensional basis, this x, so this is x is a continuous. So x is equal to 0 is there, minus is there, plus is there, real number is there, irrational numbers is there, every numbers are included. It's a continuous basis. So x is a R. Okay, x belongs to R. So this ket x form a basis. That set of vectors form a basis. So in that case, what is the orthogonality condition between them? Okay, here you got bra phi I ket phi j is equal to delta ij, because this is a Kronecker delta for a discrete case. So here I cannot write it is delta x x prime, Kronecker delta x x prime, because this x and x prime are continuous numbers. So you know the generalization of from the discrete case. So discrete delta function, Kronecker delta function, to continuous thing is basically the delta function, Dirac delta function. So this is a Dirac delta function. So the condition is this, when x is equal to x prime, the value exists and otherwise it is 0. Okay.
Sir.
Yeah.
When you write ketx, it is a representation, an abstract representation of a position vector, is it in, sir?
Ketx is a basis vector. So what is, so how do I define x, ketx? Okay, so how do I define ket x? It is, okay, if you come to quantum mechanics, okay, so if you want to say, so this is basically if I, any function if you take f of x, because nothing to do with what is that, whether this f of x anything to do with quantum mechanics, no, okay, but this f of x can be something like x f, okay. So then what is ket x? Ket x is an eigenstate of an operator x. There is an operator x. So ket x acting on ket x, the x operator acting on ket x will give you some number and x. So this is the definition of ket x. What is a ket x? It is an eigenstate of the operator x. And what is this eigenvalues? These eigenvalues are basically the numbers, okay. Need not be the position, okay. It is just a continuous numbers from minus infinity to infinity. So yeah.
How then it goes for a, we have written ket r, r vector. So this will be again.
Yeah.
So
this is a ket r, okay. So there is an r operator, okay. So R operator acting on, okay, so ket R giving you R ket R, okay.
So this this first R will be the magnitude of the vector.
So this
itself.
So that is the problem here, because when you talk about a three dimensional space, you consider one point. That one point I can represent using three numbers, okay, that is x, y, z, okay. So that three numbers, instead of just a single number, because when you go to the one dimensional case, I represent, say, any point on this line, so I can represent using a number, that is x. Now when I go to the three dimensional space, or otherwise go to the two dimensional space, I represent a point on that using a two numbers, okay. So I am forming a vector. So this is a when I went to the psi of r or the ket r, when I now actually I am interested in quantum mechanics, it is nothing to do with a general case, okay. So if I have a particle, in a three-dimensional space, so how do I represent that particle? Okay, how do I represent a particle? So earlier I told you that I can represent any system in a any physical system using an abstract notation. Okay, but this is a system in a three-dimensional space now. It's a system in three-dimensional space. So now, what is the corresponding wave function you want to talk about? The corresponding wave function, what you want to talk about is, it is the inner product with the position, the r, this get r is basically the position vector of that point. Okay, so that, yeah.
Sir, what is basically wave function? What it represent?
One second, just hold on. Okay, so what is a wave function? Okay, there are two questions I have to answer now, the ket r, and now new question is the wave function. Okay, so when we talk about the wave function, okay, so let, I don't need the three dimensional case, so we will come back to the three dimensional case little later. So wave function is, so a system, suppose the system is not interacting with any other particles or the environment, okay, a one-dimension system. I mean, suppose a particle moving in a one dimension, or a one-dimensional harmonic oscillator, or a one-dimensional potential is there, a particle moving inside that one-dimensional potential. So anything, okay, any physical system. So I can represent that system using a wave function, a state. So this is but basically the quantum mechanics starting. Okay. So any, so this is a vector. You know that the now definition of the vector is not the vector you have been thinking about. This is also a vector in some linear vector space. So I am getting into that in quantum mechanics, what kind of linear vector space you should have. So it is a vector in a linear vector space. So this actually represent one particular particle. It can be electron. It can be any other one ball moving in one dimension. Or this is a three-dimensional object. In that case, I have to go to the three-dimensional case. Okay, I'll write like this and that, but I'm not getting into three-dimension now. So I'm just talking about one particle moving in this one dimension. Okay, it is moving in this one dimension. So I represent, so quantum mechanics tell you that I can write using this vector. So why do you want to write like this? Because all information about that particular particle is actually there in this state. So this is a state of that one particular physical particle. Now, if I take this, okay, so what is this? This is, so operator I am now going to talk about that, okay. So this is basically an eigenstate of the operator x, okay, with eigenvalue x. So x is the any number. So this is a one dimension. One dimension basically means I can go from minus infinity to infinity. So the x can take any values from minus infinity to infinity. So you can actually, so what is the, so I want to find out where is the particle. At the here or here or here. So you call this x1, x2 or x3. So that depends. Okay. So that is this basically axis. The particle position can be anywhere between minus infinity and infinity. But this ket x is an eigenstate of that operator x with eigenvalue x, which is basically the position. Okay. It's not the position of the particle. It's just a position because this particle is in one dimension. Now this quantity, I'm talking it as psi of x. I'm just now giving you brief quantum mechanics. Okay. So because you asked that question. So this is psi of x. Is a wave function. So this is the wave function of that particle. Yes.
So meaning it tells us the position and information about that particle.
So now I get wave function. What you can do with that? Okay, because this is a wave function. Because there is no, this is not a physical quantity. Okay, it's not a physical quantity, but I want to have some physical quantity. Now I want to find out. Okay, it's only for your question. Okay, so I want to find out the position of that particle. How do I find out the position of that particle? So quantum mechanics tell you that you cannot actually find out the position arbitrarily, arbitrary position, because delta x 0, you cannot do that. I can only find out on an average. Okay, particle, you can actually in principle you can find the particle anywhere between minus infinity and infinity. So what is the average of average, or what is the where you are going to suppose find out that particle? So in that case you have to find out the average, that is basically the expected value. The expected value of that is nothing but the state you write, the operator you write, and the state you write. This is called the expectation value of the operator x. So it will give you the expected value of that particle, okay, position. So this is an observable in quantum mechanics. So it will give you, so it is also denoted as average x. So if I do that, you may get some number that may be x1 or x2 or x3. Okay, so you are expected to find that particle anywhere to minus infinity and infinity, but when you calculated that, you got some average value that can be this. But it does not mean that next time when you same condition, next time measure you get, when you actually physically measure you get that. No, you don't get that. This is the theoretical value. So because there is always a delta x, the variance is there. Anyway, we'll talk about variance and all little later. Okay. So from
the probability meter.
No, I not yet come to the probability. This is purely a expectation value of the x. So how do I relate? Because you know this. You are first time actually in this class, you are hearing about the ket psi. You know only about the wave function. Okay. So now 1 second. Okay, so now this quantity, whatever you learned yesterday, okay, so let us see this. What is this quantity? This one I have written as psi x psi. Okay, so now I will introduce the completeness relation in between. Okay, I will introduce the completeness relation in between these two places. So what will I get? So I get bra psi integral dx prime bra x prime, then this operator x, then one more completeness relation I will write down, so that is integral dx double prime x double prime bra x double prime, then ket psi. These two integrals I can take it outside. This is dx prime and the dx double prime. Dx prime, dx double prime. This is bra psi ket x prime. What is bra psi ket x prime? By definition. Bra x ket psi is psi of x.
Conjugate of.
This is psi star of x prime. So psi star of x prime. Now what I am having here in between is bra x prime x double prime. That quantity I keep it like this. This is anyway bra psi ket x prime, you are written as psi star x prime. Then bra x prime ket x double prime, I just written like this. Okay. So what else is left is bra x double prime ket psi. What is bra x double prime ket psi?
Psi x
double prime. Okay. Psi x double prime. Clear?
sir.
Now,
yes.
I will remove this. So, there is one more thing you have to solve here. What is bra x prime x x double prime? What is x? Yes?
Sir, between values, x operator.
It's an x operator, yes, it is an x operator.
Yes.
It was an x operator, okay. So, what is bra x prime x operator on x? And so, this is basically expected value, it's not an expected value, okay. Expected value means it has to taken with respect to the same state. But you should know what, so if you want to calculate this quantity, you should actually calculate what is, you should know what is x operator acting on x double prime. What is x operator acting on x double prime?
X double prime
ket x double prime, okay. So this will be equal to x prime x double prime x double prime ket x double prime, okay. So this is a mathematical physics now, okay. So don't worry, there is no physics I am now saying, okay. So this is equal to what? So x double prime, that is a number, I can take it outside. So, what is bra x prime ket x double prime? What is this quantity?
Delta
x prime minus x double prime. Fine? So, now I substitute that inside this. So, I get this is equal to integral dx prime dx double prime psi star x prime psi x, these are all now numbers, I can, because there is no operator, there is no differential thing, so I can keep it anywhere I wish now. So this is x double prime delta x prime minus x double prime, okay. Can you simplify this? Can I simplify this?
One integral I can
remove. I can remove either x prime or x double prime. I can use the delta function property. Okay. So what will you get? Integral dx prime psi star x prime psi x prime x prime. Okay. This anyway, integral is basically infinity minus infinity to infinity. So, this integration variable prime I can just remove. So, what is psi star x psi x prime? Mod psi of x square x. Right? So, this is the answer for what? This quantity, average value of x. So now you will understand that from the probability I am going to teach, probability theory. Okay. If I have a probability density function, say probability density function which is p of x, I have a probability density function. So to find out the average value of x, what I should do is, probability theory, nothing to do with the classical mechanics or quantum mechanics. Okay, it's a probability theory. So, in the probability theory, if I have a probability density function, if I want to find out the average, basically, you are throwing a ball from in one dimension. Okay, so there is a height, I am just throwing the ball up. Okay, 100 times I am doing it. Okay, and so what I do is, each time it reaches some height, that height is basically x. So if I want to find out the average of x, because x is a continuous, because any point it can take. Okay. So what I should do, so it's the probability theory, this is nothing but integral p of x, x dx. I am going to teach you the probability theory, so you will understand that if I do this calculation, I will get the average value of x. Okay, so one time you must have got 1.01 meter. Next is 1.02 meter. Finally, you find the average. What is that average? If I know the probability density function corresponding to the whatever distribution you are talking about, I can P of x, x dx. But quantum mechanically, this what you have got is dx x mod psi x square. Now you can see, look at this as a probability density function. Okay, so mod psi of x square is like a probability density function. So that is the place the probability theory comes into the picture. Okay, so mod psi of x square is the into dx will give you the probability to find x and x plus dx. If you find out the if you want to find the dot average of x, you multiply with the probability density function and calculate this. If you want the average square, the x square average, you calculate this. If I know x average and x square average, I can find out the standard deviation. Okay, so those things we'll teach later on. Now you see how the probability theory coming into the quantum mechanics. So mod psi of x square is, so psi of x is a wave function, it is a function, there is no physical meaning to that, but from there you can actually calculate the probability density function, then you can calculate the average value of the position, even moment, so that's what I want to get into the momentum. Okay, so momentum, then any other averages you can calculate. So is this clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So, P operator acting on, so the position basis already you know. Now the another momentum basis, so that is momentum vectors, basis vectors are basically the eigenstate of the momentum operator with eigenvalue P. Now we are talking about one dimensional case, okay. So the same state you have been discussing earlier gets psi, because this one you know that it is equal to psi of x, position wave function. So it is not just a wave function, it is position wave function. So how did you get that? We already done that, right? Because you inserted the completeness relation for the x basis. So similar job you can do. So this also form the momentum basis also will have a delta p minus p prime, also integral dp ket p bra p is equal to identity. Okay, so now similar way I can write down p psi is equal to psi of p. So same state gets psi. So when I expand at gets psi in position basis, what I got was psi of x ket x. So same gets psi, I can expand it in the momentum basis, then I get psi p ket p. I am not doing how you are getting it, because you just insert the completeness relation here, then you get this. So the same, so this is, see, ket x is a basis. So like I have a vector here, I can represent this vector in x cap, this x cap and y cap. I can also represent this vector in some other x prime and x y prime basis. So same vector only, but I can represent in different basis. So ket psi I represented in ket x, okay, same vector I represent in the basis p. So the psi x is the expansion coefficient in the when you represent it in the position basis, and psi p is the wave function corresponding to that ket psi vector when you represent it in the momentum basis. So this is psi of x. So this is the most, so there are position wave function or momentum wave function or position representation of the vector psi or momentum representation of the vector psi. Now, are they related? Psi x and psi p, are they related? Obviously, they should be related. How are they related? So, what you do is, you write down k psi, which is, you use this representation, okay. So, what I can do is, so this is more than enough, okay. Yeah, so I can, what I do is, I will take bra p from the left hand side. Okay, so I'll take bra p from the left hand side. So if I take bra p from the left hand side, what will you get? Understood? The same thing I take. Okay. So if I do bra p psi, which is equal to integral dx psi of x bra p x, okay. So this anyway, I am not going to do this. What is this quantity equal to? This is a one dimensional case, is basically this. This is proportional to e power minus I p okay. So, bra p ket x is proportional to e power minus I p x, x component of the momentum, x divided by h cross. Okay. That you will solve it in your quantum mechanics class. So, this one is equal to dx with some constant that I write here. Okay. Psi of x. So, this is e power minus I p x x h cross. So, this bra p psi is nothing but psi of p. So, this is a very beautiful thing. If I know the momentum position wave function, I can calculate the momentum wave function. Whoever knows the Fourier transform, they easily recognize that it is the Fourier transform of the position wave function. So, if I want to know the momentum wave function, I have to do the Fourier transform of the position wave function. Otherwise, if I know the momentum wave function, I have to do the inverse Fourier transform. Anyway, the Fourier transform, you learn it in your mathematics course or awareness course. I am not going to teach that, but it is basically the Fourier transform. Yeah. So, any questions so far? So, these things you can easily generalize to the three-dimensional case for the position and momentum eigenvectors. Then I can write down a three-dimensional position and momentum vectors. That is nothing but psi and p. So right now I am just introducing this. You will learn more about this. Whoever the BTech students will learn more about these things in your quantum mechanics class. But now you got the idea. And so this psi r and psi p will be related by a Fourier transform. Three-dimensional Fourier transform. Okay, so you can, because instead of I p x by h cross, what you get is basically the p x will be equal to e power proportional to e power minus I p dot r by h cross. It's a very this you can actually derive. Okay, so you can do that. Not x, r. So you have this idea now. Later on in your other courses, you will learn more. Shall I continue for some more time? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So now, because you already talked about linear vector space and some quantum mechanics already you know. So now let us think about what is an Hilbert space. So there is a linear vector space and suppose you have a sequence phi 1, phi 2, etc. There is a sequence and in this sequence if the phi n minus phi m, if this difference goes to null vector, when limit nm tends to infinity, so we say that this sequence is a Cauchy sequence. You may have already learned about this. So basically what happens is if there is a Cauchy sequence, limit n tends to infinity, the ket phi n will goes to ket phi, because this difference should goes to a null vector. So when is a linear vector space V a complete linear vector space? So where linear vector space is a complete linear vector space, if the O, so this is called ket phi is called a limiting vector of this Cauchy sequence. Okay. So if the linear vector space contains all the limiting vectors of these Cauchy sequences, then we say that that linear vector space is a complete linear vector space. Now what is an Hilbert space? If your linear vector space is a complete linear vector space and the inner product is defined in that linear vector space, then you say that that is an Hilbert space. Is that clear now? So the Cauchy sequence limit goes to a vector, limiting vector phi, and there is a linear vector space. And that linear vector space, all the Cauchy, see there may be so many Cauchy sequences and all the limiting vectors of that Cauchy sequences is also a member in that linear vector space, then you call that as a complete linear vector space. And if Hilbert, inner product is defined in that, because all the linear vector spaces inner product is not defined. Okay. So if the inner product is clearly defined in that, then we say that it is an Hilbert space. So quantum mechanics basically happens in a Hilbert space, where it is a linear vector space which is basically complete and the inner product is defined. So that is one sentence answer. Okay. So if we have time, we will come back to more about the Hilbert space later on. Okay. So I don't want to get into more of this because now I just want to define the operator, its domain and linear manifold and so on. So, but at least have a basic idea regarding the Hilbert space, which is basically a linear vector space and inner product is defined and that is a complete. Okay. So, so one more thing I will define today, that is a linear manifold, because these words are important to define the operators and their properties, adjoint, all those things. So what is a linear manifold? So you have a vector space, linear vector space. So U is a subset of this vector space V. So this U is called a linear manifold if all the vectors, so this will have a, this subset will have a so many vectors. So all the vectors in that so phi n psi are the members of this set U. If this also belongs to U, then we say that the U is a linear manifold. Is that clear? So U is a subset of V, and you take any two vectors in that linear vector space, in that subset, and any general combination, because alpha and beta are linear superposition, where alpha and beta are general complex numbers. If you take any superposition of two vectors in that subset, if that also belongs to the U, then we say that U is a linear manifold. So I will ask you a simple question. Is V a linear manifold?
Yes, sir.
Okay. V is a linear manifold. So why we want to talk about a linear manifold? Because linear manifold itself may not be a complete vector space. Because why? Because identity operator may not be existing there. Identity means null vector may not be there. Okay. Is null vector is a part of this? Because there is no guarantee, right? There is no guarantee. Because this is another vector. Okay. So whatever this understanding today regarding linear manifold, Hilbert space, complete vector space. Okay. So next class we will define the linear operators and self-adjoint. Okay. Of that operators, etc. So we will get on to that. Any questions?